What's up, guys? Today's junk is a follow-up video on the bug-out vehicle build, the 92 F-150. When you last saw this truck, I was able to get the bed off for the first time ever using the Jegs gantry crane and the Harbor Freight electric hoist. I was also able to remove the bumper, the brackets, and the gas tank along with all that stuff. So today, we're back at it. It's Saturday, so Tina, my beautiful wife, has given me permission to work on the truck on Saturdays. So here we are. Saturday, otherwise known as truck day. So we are working on the truck again today. The plan for today is to remove the rear axle and differential, the leaf springs, the shocks, all that stuff, and try and get that out for rebuild. It's the 8.8 at the moment, and I've considered kind of swapping in a heavier duty axle from, you know, Dana 60 or whatever. That's kind of, I'll be honest with you, kind of above my skill set at the moment, and there's a lot to learn, at least for me, in order to do that successfully. So my plan is to take this 8.8 out and rebuild it, beef it up with stronger axles, maybe a truss, you get the idea. Make this 8.8 worth it to keep it in the long run. And then in the future, if I decide to swap something else in, that's in the future. But for now, we're gonna stick with the 8.8. So I gotta get it out in one piece and keep it so I can rebuild it. So let's go outside and you'll see where we're at. At the moment, I already have the bed off, the rear wheels are off, the frame is jacked up, and I'm able to start removing some stuff. All right, so here's the truck as it stands at the moment. I was able to get the rear wheels off and jack up the rear differential a little bit to get these high height jack stands underneath the frame. And this is pretty rock solid, the way I have it set up. These jack stands are good for 10 tons each, so the pair can hold 20, and they go excessively high. So you could probably go about this high or so. So I don't need it for that height, but this definitely works. Now the biggest problem I have is that the driveway is actually sloped towards the street. So you never want to jack up the rear of a vehicle, that's rear wheel drive at least, and just hope that it doesn't move. Once you take the weight off of these wheels, the front wheels, at least on my truck, are gonna freewheel, and this could slide down. So I got these jack stands. I also up front put some tapcons into the concrete with a D-ring, and have a chain going from the D-rings to the frame itself. I'll show you a picture as an overlay at this moment. And that is holding the truck to the driveway, and this thing, it's not going anywhere. I'm super happy with how this turned out. So I do have a floor jack underneath the differential there, taking some weight off. That allowed me to remove the rear wheels. I'm going to eventually, again, get all these springs and the wiring and the everything out of here so we can start repairing the frame. There's some rust issues. We're gonna restore this frame as best as we can. Now, as far as these cross members go, this one in the back is probably the saddest one. It's thinning. I'm gonna have to replace that or repair it. This one seems okay. I should be okay with that one the way it is. And this one here, this needs to be inspected some more at the moment, but this one seems to be all right as well. Anyway, lots of rust. We're gonna get at that probably next Saturday. Let's get all this stuff out in the meantime. All right, so off camera, I was able to remove the U-bolts on both sides. They came off pretty easily, but it took some, impact wrenching. Anyway, next we're gonna get rid of the drive shaft in the back here. This is a 12.12 millimeter fastener head. And the drive shaft, if you remove it, at least on this truck, you can slide it forward and then pull it out of the back of the transfer case. So there are four of them. One, two, three, four, yep. And I'm gonna use an extension. These are usually in here pretty good because there's a red Loctite. Now I have had this off before in the past, so it might come out a little easier. There you go, that's one. That's two. That's three. Now, a long time ago, I learned a very hard and scary lesson. I was under the truck and I was removing this drive shaft, like I said before, and I had one fastener left and it was really putting up a fight. I didn't realize that the second I disconnect this drive shaft, the rear wheels, like I was just an idiot, the rear wheels were disconnected from the transmission, which is what puts the car in park. So transmission's in park, but it's not connected to the rear wheels. Now everything just free spins. The truck started rolling backwards while I was underneath it. I rolled out of it. I saved the day. I saved my own life. It was scary for a quick couple of minutes. The only thing that I think saved me was I had a camera under there, and that got ran over, and I think that slowed the truck down just long enough for me to get out of the way. So we have one fastener left, and it's in a weird position with the drive shaft. So at this point, what I'm going to try and do is I'm going to put the truck in neutral, and I should be able to spin this. Again, everything is secured. I got chains up front holding the truck to the concrete, and I have jack stands back here that are 20 tons worth. So this should be fine, but I'm gonna give it a shot and see what happens. Again, put it in neutral and then I can free spin this. All right, truck is in neutral. Let's see if this works. There you go. All right, a little easier to get to now at this point. And just so I don't forget, once that's out, I'm gonna immediately go put the truck back in park. Even though it really won't do much, it's just what I think is best for memory's sake. Now the thing with these drive shafts is that they're heavier than they look, but they're also not that heavy in the end, so they come right out. So you got your front U-joint, and you got a rear U-joint that goes to the pumpkin, the differential. I'm gonna put this drive shaft somewhere safe, but in the meantime, what we should be doing, so I don't lose all these fasteners, just put these back, at least temporarily. They don't even need to be snugged down, but this is just gonna keep me from losing stuff. Again, I'm kind of an idiot. So keep them here, nice and safe. This is a trick that I learned through trial and error of losing bolts over and over. Every time I go to put something back together, I wouldn't be able to find a fastener. So that's that. All right, now looking at the differential itself, I think I'll have more access if I can get these shocks out of the way. This, if I remember right, is an 18 millimeter. I did loosen up the top ones already. The bottom ones, so the top is just a stud, and you have a bolt or a nut that goes on the stud. Down at the bottom, you have a bolt that goes through with a nut. So a full-blown fastener down at the bottom. Bottom, you need a wrench and a socket. Up top, you need just a socket. So let's get these guys out of here, and that'll be the next step. All right, like I said, they come right out. Put that back on here. Again, I'm an idiot. Don't want to lose it. I'm going to grab a wrench for the bottom. All right, so that is shock. All right, no big deal. These are just regular run-of-the-mill shocks I got from local auto parts store years ago. They still work as far as I know, but I'm going to be putting brand new shocks on this anyway. And, you know, I might need a new shock mount and stuff like that. So all this might get replaced in the end, but these shocks are on their way out. And yeah. All right, let's get the other one out too. These are Monroe Reflex shocks. I don't know if they're any good. I mean, when I was replacing these, I do not remember having the mindset of the cheapest is always the best, at least with this. And I got probably a mid-level. So again, Monroe Reflex, they did me okay, but we're gonna be doing something a little different in the future. All right, now we're on the other side of the truck. We gotta find the right sockets. I'm going to remove this bracket here. This bracket actually holds the brake line that runs across, and a couple other things. This is the e-brake cable, and then this is the vehicle speed sensor that should just pop right out. These old Fords, from year to year, they seem to put this in a different spot. In my 92, and I think it's the same for a 93, this is where the speed sensor goes. Other times it's in the back of the transfer case or even in the transmission. Don't quote me on the transmission, but I know there's one in the transfer case. Besides that, I have a breather hose for the differential, and then I have
you know, brake lines and all that stuff that just got to get pulled out. So once I get all that stuff out of the way, I'm going to lower the rear differential and the axle tubes, and then try and disconnect it from the springs that are still kind of, I think, just by weight connected. So eventually we're going to get this differential out and it will get the springs out of the way. So let's get this bracket out here. That looks like a 12 millimeter. Let's find out for sure. A lot of this stuff is just getting replaced. So, nope, not a 12, probably a half. Let's see, half. Yep, half. All right, so a lot of this stuff is just getting replaced in general. And because of that, I don't have to necessarily be super kind to it all, but I don't want to just start ripping stuff out either. I kind of want to be like semi-professional here, I guess, if that is such a thing for me. And yeah, all right, so that bracket's out. I'm going to put the fastener back in. Next, let's get that speed sensor out of the way. Yeah, okay, so speed sensor, electrical connector, and has, I think, what it would be called a tone ring on the inside. And we're going to find out in a moment. That happens to be another 12. Yeah, so that came right out, and that's what you're looking at here, okay? And then some kind of gasket material. It's bizarre. So you got the brake line that comes down from the frame, from the front, makes a turn here and goes into this brake line that then goes to the splitter for the differential. I got to get this off, and that's just about everything besides the emergency brake cables that's holding the differential in place. So it's one of the last things I got to get. But the issue is there seems to be some sort of clip here that I got to get out, and this thing is super rusty. So I got a feeling I'm going to be working on this thing for a little while. And yeah, I might have to pound this sucker out. Wow, just like that. All right, there we go. It wasn't too bad after all. All right, so that came out. The clip is somewhere in my backyard. And I just got a couple other things. I'm gonna cut these zip ties here, these little cable clips, and get the electrical out of the way. Okay, here we go. I don't even have to cut them. This is going a little better than I expected, to be honest with you. I wasn't expecting too much easiness. I'm gonna have to cut some stuff, but let me reposition the camera and show you where we're at. Let's cut a couple of clips, start getting this stuff out of the way. You know, one thing that my wife keeps asking me is, do you know how to put all this back together? Long answer is no. Short answer is I'll figure it out. I guess that goes the other way around, doesn't it? Long answer is I'll figure it out. Short answer is no. All right, so all that's gone. We got the brake line. All this stuff goes to the gas tank here. This is the brake line. No, that's the breather. Okay, so the breather is gonna get replaced, and I have this run all the way up to the front of the engine. So I'm going to just cut this breather here. And if it's not the breather, I'll figure something out. Yeah, no, wait, here. We'll just pull it off that way. There you go, that's out of the way. All right, so the brake line is disconnected. The only thing left to do now is get rid of this e-brake. Now, the e-brake is gonna be a problem only because it's always a problem. It's just, it is what it is. But soon we'll be able to lower this differential from the vehicle. All right, so what you're looking at is a typical drum brake on the 8.8. I'm going to be pulling this off. And ultimately, one of my goals is to just convert to disc brakes anyway. This is all cruddy, man. All right, so anyway, this is the axle here. This is where the wheel gets hooked up. The drum brake, you got your shoes and all that stuff. The e-brake cable should come in somewhere towards the bottom here. And I just gotta be able to find that clip. I might have to remove all this stuff, which is always fun. I love drum brakes. But we're gonna be switching
to disc brakes eventually. The 8.8 came in a variety of vehicles for a number of years, and some options had the disc brakes. So we're just going to be kind of using that stuff to convert this to disc brake in the end. So I'm going to get some drum brake tools and kind of break this apart, get everything out of the way, so we can then remove that cable that goes through the back here. We'll have to do the same thing on the other side. I was able to remove all the drum brake pieces. Now, I didn't include that in the video because, to be honest with you, I am not 100% confident in how these go together off the top of my head. I did replace all this at one point, but I've only ever done it once. So my mindset today is just get stuff off, and you know, I got a variety of pieces here. So bunch of springs, bunch of clips and all that stuff. My goal at this point was just to get the e-brake cable out. Now, here's the issue. It comes in from the outside, or from underneath the truck, through the backing plate. And then you got this thing connects to one of the shoes, and there's this bunch of springs that push both shoes out when you step on the e-brake. Anyway, the biggest problem I had was this clip here, or this section of the clip. It might be difficult to see, but this has like barbs. So this is designed to be pushed through during assembly, but it's kind of difficult to take out considering everything you got to get done. So the best way to do this that I found was to take like a half inch socket and feed it through on top of these clips, pushing them in so you can pull it out. Now, I didn't have a half inch socket within reach. I happen to use the same wrench that I was using for the brake lines. Different size, but I grabbed a bunch of these. So I had this right next to me, and it just fit through. It compressed those clips like so, and I was able to pull it through. So this side is done. I'm now going to go do the other side. I'm not going to bore you with that, but you're going to see after that's done what comes next. Now, at this point, I don't think there's anything left to do but to try and remove the rear axle here. So I'm going to put some tension on it so I can at least lower the setting on the jack stands. Okay. And I'm pretty sure that it's just gonna fall. So I should probably have a second person here, but let's get this bucket out of the way. But I don't. So you know what? Let's not be hasty. Yeah, that's just gonna fall. So they are already disconnected from the leaf springs, and if I just lower it, I should be able to just ease it onto the jack stand. So let's not do it all at once like the original plan. Let's see if I can do it in stages. Nice and slow. So the springs are still have some tension, and they're literally pushing the literally pushing the axle down. So I was able to do this in a controlled fashion all by myself, and so things are starting to fall off here. I'm gonna get another jack stand and put it under the yoke, I think that's what it's called, just to help steer the fall. So, because this thing is heavy and I don't want to, you know, get it damaged or anything. So there's there we go. Okay. The front is supported. The ends will be supported. This end's already out, just about anyway. So when I lower it, this end, yep, there it goes right there. Putting that jack stand in the front was the right call. All right, so that's out. When I remove that part, I'm not even sure what this is called, to be honest with you. This thing here. But we are disconnected. I just got to lower it safely in stages since it's just me. And let's go from here. Here we go. Nice and easy.
Now it's just gravity. Yeah, this is heavier than I want to deal with myself, but I can do it. I just don't want to. Let's lower this one a little bit. Yeah, I think the jack is the only thing holding it up at this point. So we'll lower that nice and easy. Again, I don't want to just have it drop. All right, that front jack stand's tipping it. So let's there it goes. All right. Really need a second person here, to be honest, but I can do this. I've done worse. I just need to grow another set of hands. All right, so if I let it go here, there you go. Center gravity. It's physics, people, it's physics. So, nice and easy. Right onto the jack stands. There you go. How about that? Not bad. Not bad for one dude. And yeah. Okay, so now I gotta get that thing out of here. It doesn't look like I forgot anything. Everything seems to be disconnected. So I'm going to muscle this thing free. The next part you're gonna see is me getting the leaf springs off and seeing what I can do there. So off camera, I'm gonna struggle and get this thing out. All right, so temporary change of plans. I realized that it would actually be easier to wheel this thing out with the leaf springs removed. So I started doing that. There's four fasteners, one here, and that's the same thing on the other side. So I started getting them loose. Everything came loose except this one so far. I'm gonna have to work on that one. But what we got is a situation where the spring is being held in by at this fastener right here. It's loose and it's almost coming out, but I gotta figure out how to get it out the rest of the way. Same thing on this one and you know, the rear on the passenger side and the front on the passenger side as well. So I have this pickle fork and I'm thinking if I put this in here like that and then use a hammer to kind of pound the fastener out, that should release the spring. I'm gonna, of course, that washer is still here. So let's get a hammer and give that a shot. Here goes nothing. Now, I'm assuming that, better safe than sorry, that there's some sort of tension on this spring. So we're gonna kind of step off to the side here. Now it may just fall to the ground, it may fly up in the air, we'll see. Doesn't look like much more is going to happen here. Oh, there we go. Hit some kind of rough spot. Almost, just about done. All right, now at this point, yeah, these things are pretty heavy. There we go. All right. One off. Let's go get the other side off, and then we'll come back and we'll deal with this fastener here that's putting up a fight. Get your tootsies out of the way just in case. Bucket. Yeah, okay, good. Easy peasy.
Take your time. You can figure it out. Now, if you don't have a pickle fork, you could probably rig something up similar. I'm just spitballing here with a big open end wrench. You put the open end wrench as if it was the pickle fork down with the bolt going underneath. And then you use the open end wrench, or crescent wrench, if you will, to pound it off to the side. Now, the passenger side is going to come off a little easier, only because of the fastener already being loose. So, there we go. That's out. I got chaos. All right, so that's the leaf spring. We're going to put this guy back inside the garage and, safekeeping. So on a side note, I like the idea of keeping the leaf springs and actually the drums themselves, because they're big, heavy pieces of metal. It could be repurposed for other things. I don't know. We'll see what happens. But I got to get this guy out, and I'll put this leaf spring in there too. After that, the only thing that's left is just a bunch of cables and wiring and stuff like that. And the rear half of the frame would be naked for the first time since sometime in 1992. All right, let's get this guy out of here. I gotta figure something out. So this is where we're at. We got the differential free. We got the leaf springs out on both sides. Everything's being held up by these awesome jack stands. Again, link in the description. I'm using Harbor Freight's transmission jack to help move that around. I'm probably going to keep it underneath for now, just because each time I'm done with this, I got to put the bed back on the truck, because the bed's in the street and the truck's in the driveway. That's what it is. So what I was able to do after all that was I kind of went through and I pulled out some of the breather hoses and the electrical wiring and stuff like that. Just tucked it up out of the way so it won't be in the way when I go to do more work. The brake lines, they're still in this area here. Same thing with the fuel lines. They're free. I can move them around. There's plenty of play for me to get behind them and start cleaning up the frame. But they're still there. And this is the bracket for the emergency brake. That's still there. The last thing is these shackle brackets. I guess that's what they're called. These bolts here on both sides, they're frozen in there pretty good. So I'm going to grind them off, just get new bolts. But this is where we're at. So everything's removed, and next is just starting to clean up the frame. All right, so that's it for today. I'm tired. It's been a long day. I did get a lunch break. Tina made me a fantastic post-Thanksgiving lunch. Again, this is Saturday after Thanksgiving. So she made her homemade version of a gobbler. Now, if you're not familiar, in this area of the country, we have Wawa. It's a food chain. It's kind of like, what's another one? Quick Check, Tim Hortons, Royal Farms, 7-Eleven. It's probably a national thing that you might know, 7-Eleven. Anyway, so Wawa has this thing every Thanksgiving time called a gobbler. It's a sandwich, mashed potatoes, cranberry sauce, turkey, gravy, stuffing, all in a sandwich, a long roll. Here in Jersey, we would call it a hoagie roll, whatever. So I had a nice lunch and I came back out, filmed the last little bit. I'm gonna go get that muffler off. You don't need to see that. And I'm gonna throw it in the bed of the truck, and that'd be that. Next up, we're gonna start cleaning up the frame. We're gonna start with a pressure washing and then blow it off with the leaf blower. Yeah, and then I got the Eastwood kit to start painting it and all that stuff. But that'll all be in a later video. All right, guys, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you did, please click like, comment, share, and subscribe. And as always, I can be found on Twitter and Instagram at Getting Junk Done. I have an edited video, which is what you're watching now, every Thursday about 10:30 a.m.-ish Eastern Standard Time. And I have a live stream every Sunday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thanks again.